ESPN's presentation of NCAA basketball is brought to you by DirecTV. It's personalized TV. And by Chrysler. Form follows function.
Basketball team here in Amherst. Let's take a look at the starting lineup brought to you by Alcoa Building Products. First of all, for the visitors from George Washington and head coach Mike Jarvis, Rogers, Kwame Evans, J.J. Braid, Vaughn Jones, and Alexander Kuhl, the 7-1 in the middle, and he will have his hands full with Camby today. For head coach John Calipari, we will have Evans, Travioso, and Padilla in the backcourt. Dingle and Bright, and of course, Marcus Camby. Rogers outside on Padilla as we open the ball game. Camby in the middle, partially blocked by Kuhl, gets his own rebound, and he'll follow it for two. Scores, taking it up against the big fella.
One of the ways you negate a shot blocker is you put your body on him and go right to his face. And depending on how it's officiated, how physical the officials allow Kuhl to be inside, I think that will have a large part in what this game becomes. He really can give Camby problems because he's so strong, and that time he just backed him down inside.
Mark, any other keys that you see in this ball game today?
I think the free throw game. In both meetings last year, George Washington won the free throw game, and they shoot it 73% from the free throw line as a team.
Inside, knocked out of bounds by GW, and it'll come back to UMass. And boy, right now, they're letting them go inside. Does that favor GW?
Certainly they can't afford to have Alexander Kuhl in any kind of foul trouble early. You know, the last few games, he's only averaged 20, 22 minutes a game. He's got to be on the floor, I think, 32, 33 minutes today.
Nice move by Camby. Tried to feed inside, and the turnover. Braid brings it back up, but quickly to Rogers. Evans gets it knocked away. As Travioso was all over him defensively.
They call him the tap dancer because he favors Gregory Hines facially.
He does, doesn't he?
That time he had quick feet and quick hands.
2-2 as we're about to play the first couple of minutes of this one. And the arch rivals they are, they really go with each other. GW winning both games last year, UMass winning the two the year before that. Braid suspends, had a hand in his face, and knocks it down. It was a good job as Dante Brighton was all over it.
He can make plays out of no plays. He brings explosiveness and athleticism to the GW lineup.
Another turnover against UMass, something they have not been doing a lot of, and Rogers gets the layup, and it's 6-2, GW on top. On the bench across the way and visiting with his assistant coaches. Whistle and a foul inside. And it looks as though Kwame Evans, yes, will pick up the foul. His first and the team's first.
There you see the turnover story already. UMass comes in only averaging about 14 turnovers a game. Round already they have three, and GW converted one of those into a deuce.
They're very good at taking care of the basketball. UMass started off the year with a couple of games where they had 18 and 19 turnovers, but since then, the Dean company has really done a nice job of taking care of things, but they're not off to a good start in the turnover category. Last year, 78-75 and 80-78. First and only UMass loss here at the Mullen Center.
Actually, Ron, UMass in conference play only averaging about 11 turnovers a game.
Rogers looking inside. He'll drive it. Ow! He had dished it off to Jones. Get the easy two.
Little fella.
Well, Clark, you see him and you think, well, hey, we can mismatch against him, but he doesn't allow you to do it, does he? Camby blocked by Kuhl. It's his second block of Camby in the game. And as they battle for it, Vaughn comes away with it.
Tay Rogers driving, drawing, and dropping a dime to Vaughn Jones. And then Alexander Cool with the headband this year puts Camby's shot in reverse. And right now, Alexander Cool, that's the big and little of it there, folks.
Wade goes over to Jones.
Right now, George Washington, the more aggressive team here early on. Yep,
they really are. And then the little guy says, hey, I can get on the scoreboard as well. And Chante Rogers knocks down the jumper.
You know, they're going to play him to drive to pass. If he can make that little jump shot, he will be that much more effective for his club today. UMass wants to back off of him when he penetrates, expecting him to pass.
Padilla has the ball knocked out of bounds. That foul was on Padilla a moment ago, his first, and the first on UMass. To George Washington, off to a very, very good start. And obviously, when you come to a house like this, you take the crowd out. And they kind of silenced them right now.
You heard of smoke-free environment? Well, this is a fan-free environment right now.
Camby, because of the intimidation, Cool. And then he takes it right back, and they jam it home. Dante Bright.
Giving Camby something to think about early. I think Camby has to turn and face him, Ron. Catch it in the post, turn and face him, and use your quickness. Don't try to beat him with your back to him.
That's actually what that big man defender wants you to do, isn't it?
Exactly. Because he knows what you're going to try to do, and if he can just hold you off and stand there with his hands up, which is what Cool has done the last couple of times, he can give you problems. Penetration by Evans. Bright coming over to help out, but he's late getting there. And take a look at Alexander Cool setting a screen, forcing Travieso to change direction as he tries to defend Evans. That gives Evans the lane to the right, and he gets fouled.
Bright picks up the foul. It's his first.
And serious tie there, Coach Calipari. I've seen some wonderful ties all over the place today, Ron. Yours is impressive, and Calipari's looks pretty sweet too.
12-5, our score, George Washington.
To play for a team in the NBA, taking it downtown, crashing the boards with DirecTV's NBA team pass. At least I can follow any team, or I can give it the full court press. NBA league pass, every team, the Magic, Knicks, Rockets, Suns, up to 30 great matchups every week. Yeah, I could be out there with those guys. Really, I could. You won't find the NBA like this on cable, so call 1-800-DIRECTV.
DIRECTV presents Dish Out the Winners.
Okay, baby, it's time to predict which teams will be invited to the 1996 DIRECTV Grade 8 Festival. UMass, what a dynamite club. You gotta like John Calipari's Minutemen, Marcus Camby, he's a PT Beer, Dante Bright, he's a high riser.
To enter the DIRECTV Dish Out the Winners sweepstakes, send a postcard with the 8 teams you think might be invited to the 1996 DIRECTV Grade 8 Festival for a chance to win some awesome prizes, baby.
I mean, this club's got the whole package.
It sounds like a cliche, but we literally wanted to put luxury at the customer's fingertips. Power leather trim seats with driver's side memory.
Press here.
Dual climate zones.
Push here.
I think probably the biggest challenge was how to turn such a concept into a luxurious space for 7 passengers. Well,
open here.
Here.
Here. And here.
I guess we did it.
Twelve to five, our score, George Washington. And immediately following this game, 2 o'clock Eastern time, it's Illinois State and Bradley from Robertson Fieldhouse in Peoria. Then at 12 midnight, we're not done. Brigham Young at Fresno State. That one in Fresno. All today, right here on ESPN. Now, Mike Jarvis brought his club in as you look at logging the minutes, so to speak, of Camby Bright, Travieso, Dingle, and Padilla. Well, the two guards particularly, yeah, they don't get much rest, do they?
They play big minutes.
Bright will penetrate, and he misses the dunk. So still a 7-point margin.
when they come back down on offense, I want to get you to comment on that as Cool with the reverse here, and it hits the jump.
Alexander with the jump hook. He's got such a strong body. As long as he can keep Canby on his hip, he'll be able to be effective in the low post today.
Padilla with the jumper, not there. Canby tried to tip it away, and here comes GW. And they got numbers 4-on-1 as Grade will score. And this crowd right now was in a little bit of shock as John Calipari calls a 20-second timeout. They are down by 11 points.
Well, a poor shot was the first pass to a fast break on that possession, Ron. Padilla, before the defense had moved, jacked up a quick shot, and here's the tail end of it. Kwame in the middle handling the break, gets it to J.J. Braid. And the thing about GW, Ron, is they've got three or four guys that can lead the break. Vaughn Jones can do it, Kwame Evans can do it, and certainly Shaunte Rogers can do it. See, here's Cool. He's got Canby on his hip, and he's just as tall as Canby, a little heavier and stronger, so Canby's going to have to try to force him off the block a bit and then challenge his shot from behind.
GW 7-of-9 in the opening going here, while UMass is 2-of-7. And I started to mention Mike Jarvis just a moment ago. He brought this club down here on Thursday evening. They had a shoot around at 10 o'clock yesterday morning. And he said, simply because none of his kids had classes on Friday, but still, that showed me how big this game was to him.
Well, he wanted to get into the gym and get a workout on this floor and get his guys focused in on what they needed to do. And so far, they have executed the game plan in fine fashion.
Well, when you got a problem, you go to the go-to guy, and Canby knocks down the jam. Three-pointer on the way, and it's there.
They can't guard him if he does that. Ron, if he makes the perimeter shot, they will have a tough time with Shaunte Rogers all day long.
Padilla picks up the dribble, and he had him in his hip pocket. Nunez in the lineup, number 44. Roberto, a senior from Lawrence, Massachusetts. Does not play a great deal as the ball is turned over again, and the outlet pass to Braid, and he let him too much, and he had to throw it away, and Nunez is right there.
Too much air under that pass.
19-7, George Washington. In the middle, left alone, Dingle gets the jumper.
Boy, Alexander Cool showing us everything. He's posted up Canby by putting him on his back. That time he just held him off after he got behind him and finished inside.
And notice that Mike Jarvis got up during the 20-second timeout and talked with the officials. He was asking why Canby was not called for an over-the-back down here. But I think the officials have decided as Canby loses it, they're not going to foul those two guys out. They're going to let him play. Rogers dishes to Jones. And can't get it to go, but he'll go to the line. And I believe Dingle is going to pick up the violation.
Canby twice now is driven into the lane, and George Washington with the quick hands and the help from the weak side has made clean plays on the ball. Canby looking to draw the foul. He may need to just make one bounce, Ron, and pull up for that nice little jumper. John Calipari talked to him about that at the shoot-around. He said, turn and face, one bounce and shot. Well, Canby has tried to take it further than that, and he's turned the ball over a couple of times.
Nunez picked up the foul, and he has gone to the bench.
One. Well, there was one dribble, but he's trying to get all the way to the cup. Good hands by George Washington's weak side defender. And here's Alexander Cool using that lower body and that strength to hold off Canby, and then good patience inside after the catch.
Substitution coming in the ball game, Masherikov, 6'8", 227. He's a freshman from Minsk.
And Yegor has game, folks. One of the outstanding freshmen in the country that maybe you're not aware of. Can run the floor, can shoot the ball, and is very active at both ends.
They have got some huge bodies on the floor right now as Canby pulls up, misses the jumper, but good hustle inside as Bright came away with it. And neither guard
for UMass has scored yet, as that three-pointer is off the mark. Tyrone Weeks in the ballgame, number 34. Travioso and one of the guards would have scored now. First time at the 12:23 mark.
Mike Jarvis came over and talked to us briefly before the game. He said, if their guards get it going outside, we could be in trouble. So far, they've sloughed off the guards, and Travieso or Padilla haven't been able to make them pay yet.
Weeks doing a nice job defensively, but Cool is there to get the follow. And at the other end, it's been almost one shot and out for UMass, but not the case for GW so far.
Good call, Ron.
Smart move by Cammy to steal off Cool's backside. So let's take a break. 11:50 left until halftime. George Washington by 14 points over the number one team in the nation.
Chrysler Sebring was built upon something called the Goldilocks principle.
It occurred to us that while most luxury cars were too big, most sport coupes were too small. We wanted the Sebring to be, well, just right.
It not only has a sporty 24-valve engine and a race-inspired suspension, but it also gives you the luxury of an actual backseat.
Which means there's enough room for Goldilocks and three or four of her friends. Isn't it just like Delta to design a stylish faucet that's practical too?
Give me that.
So it's long enough to reach today's double and even triple sinks.
My turn.
Delta, the way water is brought to life.
Need a towel?
So hang on, George Washington, 25-11 out of the blocks, very strong to open this game.
And a good reason for that, Ron, the play of Alexander Cool. He's been perfect. He's had two blocks, and his physical presence so far has given Camby a little bit of a problem. It'll be interesting to see if Camby can make the adjustment, step away from the goal a bit, and try to use the quickness to take advantage of his asset against Cool's strength.
And he's getting a breather right now. Ferdinand Williams, number 43, into the lineup. We should take a look at George Washington, 10 of 13, UMass, 5 of 12.
GW has been all man-to-man, and it's been a very tight man-to-man. UMass has been unable to spread him out.
Trevieso loses the ball as Green ties him up, and possession arrow will give it to GW, and a technical foul has been called on UMass. John Calipari out on the floor.
And he's got to put it in reverse and back up. That was just a good play. I mean, Travieso was weak with the ball, and Green just stepped in and squeezed it.
Larry Limbo's the referee today. Jerry Donaghy and Gene Monchi are the umpires, and it was Monchi who teed up Calipari.
Well, I think John has been a little frustrated. There you take a look at him. Let's take a look here. See, watch this. This is just pretty good D, folks. Well, he did get a little bit of the elbow prior to that. From the angle I saw it at first, I didn't see the flick on the elbow. But still a pretty good position with the feet, and when you're in position with your feet, now your hands can become active and be a factor.
This is a message, technical, you know it is. Not only to the officials, but to his ball club. Because if they have not gotten the wake-up call yet, I mean, they're kind of sleepwalking through it.
Well, George Washington certainly is taking the starch out of their shirts, no question about it. But this team, this UMass team, has shown time and time again during this streak run that they can deal with adversity. They've come back a number of times. Now, they've got a lot of work ahead of them now, but still an awful long way to go in this one. But they've got to turn up the aggressiveness to get back in it. I don't know what the summit is about now.
The discussion is, I think, about the possession arrow, because they had called a tie ball
right
before the technical foul. And a possession error showed it was with George Washington. And it'll stay there. because of the technical.
Oh, thank you. Okay, you're right. Okay.
Battle inside. Gamby comes away with. By the way, that's second game in a row now that Coach Cal has gotten the technical. Jumper from 16, well off the mark, and Canby knocked it out of bounds. It'll go back to the Colonials. Boy, this one so far. GW has just made mincemeat of 16-point lead as we're about to go under 11 minutes to play in his opening half. Rogers couldn't get it. Padilla pushes it up, and they got numbers this time. 4-on-2. Strong to the hoop, and I don't believe it. Dante Bright missed. That's two dunks that they've missed today.
Well, he took off from too far that time, and a Colonial defender impeded his progress, and Dante was looking for the foul. But George Washington has been very good defensively. And even when UMass has gotten good shots, Ron, they haven't made them. That's why the lead is double digits.
Green, Treviso will pick up the foul.
Well, I think you're starting to see a little bit of frustration here from the sidelines for UMass and on the floor. They need some good things to happen for them. They need to get some easy baskets. They need some positive momentum, and they've got to generate it themselves.
Well, a couple of new faces come back into the lineup. Dingle is in as Canby goes to the bench, and Enos Norbill will check in. A 6'8 sophomore out of Fayetteville, North Carolina, hasn't played basketball that long. And Calipari has just been tossed from the game. His second technical, and he's gone. Larry Limbo teed him up that time.
Seems to me as though he worked on that one, though, Ron. I didn't see exactly what he said, but at some point you get upset with the officials and you make your point, you get one technical, and then from that point on I think you've got to back off a little bit.
Well, like I said, I thought the first one was just that, but well, this one certainly was not what he wanted. I know. This is the first time ever, because he's been at UMass, that he's been ejected from a ball game, getting too technical.
Well, here he is right here. This is after I think he had been whistled for the second technical. And again, I wasn't able to see exactly what prompted Larry Limbo to give him the second one, but it's a done deal now.
So with the technicals, it is now 29-11. Jones has 10 points already. Alexander Kuhl, the 7-footer, has 8 points. Three-pointer on the way, that's blocked. Treviso got a hand on it. They try to save it, and the ball is going to go to UMass. Clark, if that ball had not gone to UMass, we might have had a riot.
There's James Bruiser Flint stepping into that hot seat, and that bad boy is on fire right now. Down 18 in your own building.
Canby with the left hand gets it. He's got 6 now. But Green quickly at the other end and tries to reverse it. Can't get it. He falls down. And here they push it up. Padilla to Canby from 17.
Thank you. Now that's a sharp-looking car.
With Fields Mobile Cutlass Supreme two-door coupe, and for a limited time, it's a steal.
Oh, do tell.
Right now, it's just $219 a month for 36 months.
Nicely loaded, too.
It even has platinum-tipped spark plugs.
Platinum?
So, you could drive cross-country 33 times before a tune-up.
Wow, how much now?
$1,900, and a trade-in might cover that.
Great. $219 for how long?
Might hurry in before
this offer ends.
You catch on fast.
Demand better. See your local Oldsmobile retailer today.
You know, you're quite persuasive.
Thank you.
There's a hard-working gasoline.
You sure about this?
With the power to drive down maintenance costs.
Really? Are you serious?
Yes, we are. Exxon gasoline keeps your engine cleaner.
Clean is good.
So it can help drive down maintenance costs.
Could gas do that?
Exxon gasoline can, with the power to drive down maintenance costs.
It's a good idea.
And so is this. Cash and credit prices are the same.
Okay, I'll try it.
People stopping by to rely on the Tiger.
Shit, my friend. My agent can win one at home, but it takes a real team to win on the road. Hey, Patino's got his team. They go traveling together. Kick a little tush, and then it's back on the bus. Riding along, those cats got your number. Dick, we are Kentucky. And those cats, those cats will rock you.
That was groovy, Mr. Goulet.
Mini run by UMass. They cut it to 14, Clark.
Darren Green going to try to flush this one from the weak side. Travieso with the block. The bench is into it. And at the other end, find your go-to guy and let him get busy. The last two times, Ron, Camby has driven on cool from 12 to 14 feet away from the hole. That last shot you saw there, a 15-footer, he's got to make cool come out. He needs to look for his offense away from the paint area initially.
Because cool is in real danger when he gets him out that far.
No question about it. If he comes out there too tight, Camby will walk right around him.
Braid picks up the dribble. Over to Jones. Into the middle. Nice defensive work. Dante Bright. Jump ball is called, and it'll stay with GW.
You know a run is coming, Ron. This team has been too good for too long in a number of adverse situations. They've won games played at a number of different paces. And this is a team that has great character, I think.
No question about that. But that first 10 minutes, they did some sleepwalking, didn't they? Cool. And they're going to call
shot clock violation there. Yep. Just before Cool was able to get it up and down. Now Mike Jarvis knows his team has to weather this storm.
Trevieso with a bouncer in the middle. Bright up strong, and he was fouled. I believe J.J. Braid. No, check it. Vaughn Jones is called for the violation.
Yeah, I talked about the nice ties, Ron. You got on one. How about that one Mike Jarvis has on? We won't see Calipari's anymore today.
It was nice, though.
It was very strong.
You know, Mike Jarvis's club has committed only two first-half fouls, and we're at the nine-minute mark. The next one against UMass, and it's a bonus situation.
And you just saw an 80% free thrower miss two.
George Washington leading UMass. Got Padilla, now Travieso, I should say, in the air, and he's going to get the foul. Free throw shooting. George Washington, 8 of 8. UMass is 1 of 4.
What do we talk about at the top? The game. Two of the games within the game that I always like to look at is the free throw game and the rebounding game. Right now, George Washington is plus 7 in made free throws with a chance to go to plus 9. On the season, Ron, they've taken 76 more free throws than the opposition in conference play and made 79 more.
Trevieso picks up his second foul, so that means that Charlton Clark a freshman out of the Bronx St. Raymond's, will check into the lineup. And Clark, here's a young man that broke a bone in his foot back in the Kentucky game, missed 6 weeks. Probably the coaches say is in not the best shape as yet, but they think he's on the verge, that Clark is ready to step up big and help this ball club. Well, he gets his opportunity today.
He certainly does, and it would be a nice addition to their guard rotation because of the minutes Padilla and Travieso have to play on a game-to-game basis.
Camby reverses it. Bright on the follow, and Bright was fouled. Camby looking around, he thought he was fouled on the shot.
Here you take a look at Camby trying to spin inside against Cool. Good position there. And then Dingle, able to come loose on the weak side, and Cool clearly hacked him. That's the thing. Camby draws so much attention that Dingle and Bright oftentimes are able to shake free on that weak side board and hurts you there. Dingle, their best offensive rebounder in conference play.
Misses the second one and knocked out of bounds. Touched last by Jones of George Washington. That's the first foul on Cool, by the way. Third team foul. So UMass out of the blocks at 2-6 from the free throw line. Camby got banged that time by Cool, and the ball touched last by UMass, and that's what the crowd is upset about. Marcus really got hammered, and he's not carrying nearly as much pride as Cool is.
And the point you make there is a good one, because it'll look more like a bump when him and Cool collide than maybe it is, and the officials taking that into consideration.
Jones couldn't get it to go. Can be a strip, and they're going to call the foul on the little guy. Shante Rogers picks up his first.
See, watch this drive by Camby. Now, there's contact here, but Camby initiated that. And because Cool is so much heavier and stronger, Camby bounced off of it.
He really did.
And that was an excellent no call by the official.
Clark going to be called for the walk. Had the step, he couldn't believe he was that open, and went ahead and took another step before he put the ball on the floor. Into the middle and just knocks down that 15-footer.
That's what I liked about the play, the little curl off the down screen. His defender chased him. Anytime you're chased on a down screen, curl it into the middle and get yourself a mid-range J.
Padilla has it stripped away. Rogers comes away with the basketball, and it's a 3-on-2 break as Rabe will score it. 34-16.
Ron, are these boys hooping or what? Are they playing basketball or what out here?
George Washington saying, hey, we want to go to the big party, and a win here would certainly convince a lot of folks. Camby bounces it back into the middle, the collision, and it'll go to George Washington.
This has been evident all afternoon so far. Watch the help. Look at the yellow jerseys get to the paint. Cool, Evans, Jones, all locked in, and then Camby has to force a tough pass, and ultimately the aggressiveness of GW leads to them coming up with the turnover.
Mark, I still, when I look up at the scoreboard, the thing that surprises me most is the fact that only one field goal out of the guards of UMass. Trevioso comes up with the turnover. The put back, and they get that to go. Two jams and a layup that they missed in his first day.
Yep. Dingle chasing down the transition opportunity by Travieso.
Jones, give and go. Nice basics, and they're getting it to happen for them. They have doubled the output of UMass, 36 to 18. And in case you joined us late, John Calipari received his second technical just about 6 minutes ago, and he is in the locker room. Jumper not there. The tip outside. Trevieso, he'll put up a three, and he got it. Points for him now. Rogers way outside, off the mark, and a foul against George Washington. He'll call it on Kwame Evans. And the second foul on Kwame, as you look at those numbers.
Well, there you see the difference. The free throw game, we talked about it. George Washington has a team 73% in conference play. That is outstanding foul shooting for any team, anywhere.
Bright guarded closely. He touches nothing with that shot. Rogers out of the wing, and Evans has it stripped. Nice job, as I believe it was Padilla who got a hand on it, and Camby at the other end is tripped up on his way to the hoop by Cool. So Cool now with two fouls and 16 fouls against the Colonials.
Tough break there. Kwame Evans a bit out of control in transition, and that gave UMass a chance to get something in the open court. And here you look at Evans trying to split defenders here. He tried to split two defenders, could have pulled up or pulled it out. And then UMass goes the other way. And quite honestly, Ron, the GW defense in the half court has been splendid. One way they let UMass get back in it is if they give UMass easy opportunities in transition or on the glass.
You can see Padilla was there to take that charge a moment ago. And then Trevieso got a hand on the basketball. 36-21. A whistle and a foul away from the ball. That shot's not going to count, but I believe Rogers. Second personal foul on Rogers. And 17 fouls against George Washington. Well, nine times this year, UMass has trailed at halftime, and they have been able to come up with some kind of magic. But I'll tell you what. The trick that they pulled today is going to be the biggest of all. They got their hands full. This George Washington team, as you said, is just making everything work at both ends, and the basics are looking beautiful for them.
They're just playing a good, solid game right now. These next 4 minutes will be critical because Cool is going to have to sit the rest of the half with those two fouls, and Camby can shoot over Masharikov much easier than he can Alexander Cool. So I would think UMass, in addition to becoming more aggressive defensively, will try to attack Masharikov inside with Camby.
First 2 points of the afternoon for Padilla. And the ball is going to be stolen. Taken away by UMass as Dingle will take it all the way to the hoop, and they'll score. And a 20-second timeout is called by GW.
Just kind of a lazy pass here and an errant pass by Rogers, and Dingle just comes up with the orange. And he made up his mind at the half court stripe. He was getting this one to the rack. And it was a good choice.
Well, on ESPN2 boxing tomorrow, 9 o'clock, Eric Morales, 20-0 with 16 knockouts, takes on Rudy Bradley, who has 2 KOs of his own. He's 13-3-2, 9 o'clock Eastern Time on The Deuce. 8 points, 3 of 3 for Dingle, and 3 rebounds.
He is really solid and often unheralded and overlooked, but he's tough defensively, gobbles up second shots on the offensive glass, and right now has been a big factor in this little spurt that UMass has made.
Well, just a moment ago I said they were down by 18. It whittles 7 of those off. It's an 11-point ball game. Masharikov, turnaround jumper, he wasn't even close. Bright comes away with a rebound. And at the the other end. Canby misses. Dingle, oh, what a nice job of hustle. That ball is tipped, and George Washington will come away with it. Kwame Evans got a hand on it. Boy, if they had taken it out of double figures, this place would have gone nuts.
Oh, my.
Shante Rogers just drives a stake in their heart. A three-pointer, and that brought silence to this crowd that was erupting just a moment ago.
Little fella. Fight him down.
I'm telling you, 5-3. The lob pass knocked away by Sharkoff. Got a hand on it at the other end. J.J. Braid. And in transition.
How about the pass, Ron? He got it to his left hand because that's the only passing lane he had if he wanted to catch his teammate streaking to the hole.
So let's take a break. 3:02 until halftime, a 16-point George Washington lead.
Rough roads. Sharp curves. To keep a firm grip on roads like this depends upon your shock absorbers. Look, with a worn-out shock absorber, the wheel leaves the road. But with a new Monroe SensiTrac shock absorber, your tire holds the road. With Monroe SensiTrac, even the most demanding road feels safer. Monroe SensiTrac, making the road a safer place. Have your shocks checked every 12,000 miles just to be safe.
My daughter used to think fish just came from the supermarket.
You know, my son used to wait for rainbows, but now we go looking for them.
I know they learn all about the world in school, but now we can show it to them.
Isn't it amazing how opening one door can open up so many others? Ford Explorer, because the world's too big to be left unexplored.
You worry? You're overprotective? You're a parent. Isn't it nice to know that there's something almost effortless you can do to protect your family even more? Just ask your State Farm agent for a free family insurance checkup. It's a smart way for you to decide if your family's insurance coverage is up to date, so they'll be better protected. And maybe you'll worry a little less.
George Washington, 41-25 over UMass. And by the way, ESPN's coverage of NCAA Basketball Championship Week begins on Saturday, March the 2nd. That is on ESPN, and also NCAA Basketball Championship Week on ESPN2.
What a game and a sequence Shante Rogers has had the last two possessions here. What a sweet feed with the left hand. That's the only way he could pass that ball around the defender. And then J.J. Braid made it all work. But he had just knocked down a three. There you see his shooting. Six dimes already with 8 points and aggressive defense to boot.
Ball is kicked, so they'll add 10 on the clock and give him a fresh 35 as Evans put a foot up and booted it out of bounds. Situation, 16-point lead, GW. Both teams with 7 fouls in this first half. 12 points for Vaughn Jones and GW, and a whistle away from the ball.
Somebody threw a chicken wing, Ron. Got that elbow either too wide or too high.
Dante Bright is who they called it on. It's his second.
Bruiser Flint trying to keep his crew composed here. So far, it's been all Colonials. And they've come and taken it right at UMass.
Coming up at halftime, the Delta Fawcett halftime report. Georgetown and BC, also Thompson on Iverson and Maryland Clemson. Delta Fawcett halftime report coming up in about 2 minutes and 44 seconds. Kenny Mayne will be there for you. Canby. Jones fouled him.
He got an awful lot of that orange, though. I hear you, Vaughn.
Vaughn plays that forward spot. He is a co-captain, but talk about unselfish. He's got 81 assists on the
year. Oh, yeah, he's a tremendous all-around player. He's a facilitator. Not only does he make good passes that lead to scores, Ron, but a lot of times he'll get the ball to the guy who ends up making the assist. So he does an awful lot for the George Washington club.
That was his second foul.
We've seen Camby take control of games when his team needed him to do that. I would expect much the same the rest of the way today.
Well, now this is the largest deficit that they have had this year. 18 points was. They trailed by 16 against Maryland in the second game of the year. Save, and he threw it right to Bright. And Bright is going to miss. That's three jams in the first half that UMass has missed, and Camby is off the mark on that.
You know, Dante Bright cannot really palm the ball comfortably. And I think what happens when you can't palm it, Ron, is that it has a tendency to slip out of your hands at the very last minute, and that's why I think he's back ironed two of those three dunks he's missed.
Padilla gets this carry. Clark, would you consider three dunks this half and a missed layup?
Yeah.
That's eight sure points, which makes it a 43-35 ball game.
A whole different story. That's sometimes what it takes for the number one team to have their winning streak halted. Sure, GW is playing really well and the aggressor, but UMass has certainly cooperated with some missed shots.
Padilla and Camby with a little two-man game. Camby with the long jumper. Tip inside, won't go. Bright unlucky on that one. And he's just shaking his head as he goes down the floor. He can't believe it. Said, I never miss a tip like that. Perfect position, came right off in his hand, and he put it up with both and missed. About to go under 1 minute to play. The largest lead of the first half is 18. And George Washington can equal that on this trip right here unless they put up a three and hit it. For Bright, one of eight from the field. And the finger roll by Evans, and we're back to the largest lead that they've had in the first half. 18 points.
So Evans really strong with the ball to create that driving lane for himself.
Padilla for three. All of a sudden now the guards have 10 points, and they were devoid of points for the first half of this first half, for the first 10 minutes. 15-point ball game. George Washington wants desperately to get one more field goal before they head into the locker room.
And just as importantly, they don't want to give UMass a chance to score, although there's about a 7-second difference between game and shot clock.
As it knocked away inside, and a foul. And who did they get in there, Clark? It was a mass of bodies, and Bright was the closest man to the action. That's who it is. Bright gets his third foul, and now Bruiser Flint has picked up a technical.
A little frustration again. Bruiser Flint was continuing to voice his choice after that call. The whistle was a touch late. We were blocked out from seeing exactly how and who got in there to commit that foul, but at some point with the officials, you have to bite your tongue. Huge, Ron. He got one plus the bonus on the foul. Now he gets two for the technicals. Yeah. And he made two out of four. Plus they keep the orange.
47-30.
And they keep the ball, Ron. I mean, they can shoot the last shot now.
Sherikov on their center court, and of course, trying to get it back to the guard. Knocked away by Padilla. Jones did a nice job. He had a hurdle Padilla, who was on the floor. Under 5 seconds, he'll get the shot away. And we're at halftime. So for the Mullum Center in Amherst, they are standing and not cheering. They are booing. The officials, that is, as George Washington has a 17-point lead over the number one team in the nation, UMass. They got a mountain to climb. It's halftime, 17-point lead, Kenny Bain. Let's go back to you.
Hey, thanks, guys. I wonder if John Calipari has cable TV wherever he's hanging out right now. Welcome. This is the Delta Faucet Halftime Report. With tourney time fast approaching, we'll get you caught up on the scores that could impact the draw. And with individual award time approaching, We'll get into the hype surrounding Georgetown's
Olympic team. We are driving excitement.
We are at halftime, 47-30. The Colonials of George Washington surprising the number one team in the nation. And Clark, one number that sticks out to me, 12 first half turnovers, but also cool. He had 8 first half points, but he got 6 of those early. At least it calmed him down a little.
Exactly, and it set the tone for this game as he uses his strength to get good post position and then goes to the jump hook. You shoot 55% by getting good shots, and that's what George Washington did throughout the first half. Kwame Evans gonna go along the baseline. We're gonna pause it right here. See where Dana Dingle is? He's behind Evans. Evans is gonna continue to come, and he's gonna come right into this area here for the little half curl. And that's just excellent half-court execution.
Well, it's...
And it didn't end there. A little give-and-go action. This is Vaughn Jones, who made the pass to Bray. He just made a basket cut and got the hook.
Well, look at this balance. 7, 8, 16, 8, and 8 for the 5 starters for George Washington. By the way, neither bench has scored in this ballgame. Right?
Well, neither one of these teams play have a large bench, although GW typically gets about 10 points a game from Yegor Masharikov.
Travel against Camby, and you can see the weak side help come over as Bruiser Flint just kind of looks at the ceiling. The first half stats, 55% to 37%. As we mentioned, 12 turnovers. UMass only averages in conference games 11 turnovers a ball game. They had more than that in the first half of 12. Cool with the jump hook. Can't get it to go and knocked out of bounds by Dingle. So if you joined us late at 10:31 of the first half, head coach John Calipari headed to the locker room as he received his second technical foul. Bruiser Flint took over, and he even got a technical foul in the first half also as GW calls a 20-second timeout. You know, as I mentioned in the first half, 8 or 9 times this year, UMass has trailed at halftime. And yesterday, I had a chance to visit with John Calipari about that and ask him, you know, what did he turn on as far as his speech at halftime? What did he say?
A lot of times we're down at half or tied with the team that we should be up 15. There have been halves where we were should have been up 12 to 15, we're up 4 or 5. Those times I go in and say, that's good, because now you'll play in the second half. If we were up 15, who knows what would happen?
Clark, let me ask you, as GW has the basketball, what to you is the paramount thing that has to happen first to get that first run and cut into this lead?
Well, they've got to come up with some stops and some easy scores, Ron. Nothing has really been easy for UMass today offensively, and when they have gotten good shots, they've not put them in the hole.
Well, speaking of putting them in a hole, that's 4 fouls on Dante Bright. As you look at the trailer tied at halftime, 11 times this year at halftime. And they got to send him to the bench here.
Oh, no question.
We haven't even played 1 minute of the second half. Tyrone Weeks, 34, will check in, the 6'7 junior.
Well, Weeks coming off a game where he had 16 points and 7 boards in that win, and 9 boards in that win against Rhode Island on Tuesday. And he'll bring some aggressiveness and some toughness. Although offensively now, George Washington could have an advantage with his matchup because they've got 3 ball handlers that all like to play away from the hole. Rogers, Evans, and Jones.
Well, he misses the second one. They are 14 of 18 at the free throw line for the ball game. Weeks to Camby. As it's stripped away, and the turnover, turnover number 13.
That's the 9th or 10th steal for George Washington. Their feet have been active, so that's allowed them to get their hands on a number of dribble penetrations by UMass.
Brave with the quick hands on that one to knock it away for the Colonials. Errant pass. Cool couldn't get to it as Brave had moved it inside. Jarvis is saying he thought the ball was tipped going out of bounds.
Mm-hmm. Didn't win that.
Well, the crowd doesn't feel as though that he's lost many battles today, though, with the officials, do they?
Not at all. Padilla deep in the corner, off the mark. Cool with the rebound, and here's Rogers out to Braid. And in transition, George Washington has done a number on UMass all day long.
And Braid has been the finalizer on a number of occasions because they've been able to get clean rebounds, and he's been able to release and go to the other end.
Biggest lead of the afternoon. This is the greatest amount that UMass has trailed by all season long. They're down by 20. Camby, Cool had a hand right in his face. Weeks lost it off his foot. And with the tie ball, it will go to UMass.
Camby has to turn and face, Ron. And I said it twice in the first half. But the only way he can take advantage of his skills against Cool is to turn and face him and try to beat him. And he's got to beat him with one dribble, maybe two, because the help for George Washington has been superb from the weak side.
Well, the NHL and ESPN, the Blackhawks taking on the Flyers. This is tomorrow, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, the National Hockey League on ESPN. For Marcus Camby, whew, it has been some kind of day that they say, what, some days the magic works, some days it doesn't. He's 4 of 14 in his 10 points.
Yeah, he's had a tough day offensively, but we know he's the kind of player that can get it going and carry a team, but the weight may be too heavy today, down 20. And Donta Bright being in foul trouble and George Washington playing as well as they're playing, it could be a very difficult remaining 17-50 for UMass.
Rogers, and every time you look at him, you think a guy 5'3 can't play in Division I. He did get that blocked by Camby, but a foul was called. Marcus Camby called for the violation.
Shante Rogers, they think he's going to penetrate to pass. This time he penetrates to try to score. And Camby got a lot of the ball, but then came down on top of his head afterwards. And I think that's where the foul was whistled.
Well, this little guy at the line, when he was in high school in Baltimore, led Lake Clifton to a 4A state championship. Against Missouri early on, that's on the road. That's at Columbia, a tough place to play. He had 8 steals in that ballgame, Clark.
Oh, he's a tremendous little player. I mean, he's a basketball player. Forget about his size. I mean, that just causes you to be more amazed. But he rebounds, he can pass, and he's made timely perimeter shots so far today, Ron.
Cool is called for the foul. That's a reason for the cheer by the crowd. And one of the things Mike Jarvis said to us, obviously, can't get either one of the big people in trouble or then they've got serious, serious problems. That's 3 on Cool. Trevieso inside. Weeks has the ball jabbed away. Weeks to Camby for the jam. Misses it, and the tip.
Great
is right there. Wow.
He really gives this team athleticism along that front line. He's not very tall, but he gets off the floor quickly, and he's a tremendous runner on the break.
That ball missed by Weeks, the pass to Braid, and a nice job by Padilla getting back in transition to knock it out of bounds. One of the things an opposing coach told me about Braid, he said he is very, very emotional, and that spark is infectious to the rest of the team. Boy, does that ever describe what he's done today?
No question about it. He's been an energizer. He's been quick on defense, and he's been at the end of a number of transition opportunities for George Washington today.
Clark in the lineup, number 5. Braid is 6 of 6 from the field. Cool. Camby went in the air, got him suspended, and he jams it home. He's got 10 now. Trevieso for 3. George Washington. Kwame Evans took the step, couldn't get the ball on the floor. Jerry Donaghy, giving him a couple of pats on the backside, saying, come on, Jerry,
blow that whistle down at this end.
Cardioso had the three, passed it up. Kisses it off the glass, and he'll go to the line to try to make the old-fashioned three-point play.
You're right, Ron. He passed up a good three here and leans in. And Bray comes across the arm there. I don't know if Travieso was looking to bank that one, but at this stage, you'll take them however they come.
Aesthetics are not important.
Right.
First foul on Bray. So that's a three-point play, and now 11 for him. Timeout on the floor. 15:53 left in the ballgame. 55-38.
Show them what you've got.
They can make a rough road feel this smooth. They can make the most demanding road feel safer. And right now, Monroe SensaTrac shocks and struts are on sale. Buy three and get the fourth one free. That's one safe deal. Buy three and get the fourth one free. Only on Monroe SensaTrac. Only for a limited time. So go straight to a Monroe Ride Expert Center today. Or call 1-800-STRUT-NOW.
Hey, Red Dog.
What?
Do you ever wonder why we're here?
Where?
You know, here. Why we exist?
No.
How come?
I got better things to think about.
But why are we the way we are? I mean, I'd give anything to be as big as you.
True. You ain't big, but you're real quick.
Quick? Yeah. I guess it all evens out then, huh?
Well, that might be pushing it.
Red Dog.
Hey, Red Dog.
Yeah?
Full moon tomorrow night.
I'm there, buddy.
Hey, back to our game in a second. First, Boston College and Georgetown. Here's Allen Iverson with the ball. Allen Iverson without the ball. There goes Scooney Penn going the other way and racing in. And BC was up by 8 at that point. Now we send it back to Massachusetts and G-Dub.
Keep it going.
On our score, Kenny, 55-38. Team points for Bray today. As we mentioned, he's perfect from the field, 6 of 6. Over his average for the season. Trevieso, the hot man for UMass in the second half. He's got 8 points in this half as Rogers took it all the way to the hoop and then decided to come on back out. Evans bounces inside to Cool, falling away. Off the mark, but they get the board. Jones is there in a fresh 35 seconds.
Well, they're playing one around four right now, Brian. Cool is the only guy operating space in the low post for you, for George Washington. And they've got four ball handlers around him. Actually, three. Braid, really not that comfortable with the ball, but he's a slasher and a guy who can make plays after only one or two dribbles.
Trevieso now with three fouls. Three team fouls against the Minutemen here in the second half. Two against George Washington. Rogers penetrates, and Norville looked as though he had gotten knocked down, so he just stayed down there and tried to take the ball away from him. He's called for the violation.
Shante Rogers coming right into your screen, folks. There's the grab by Norville. Unable to break down and get around enough to cut off Shante Rogers.
Yeah, he couldn't get that ball. 6'8 and 5'3. Cool with the jump hook over the top of Norville.
Ron, what you're seeing right now is an excellent execution. See, George Washington can penetrate with three guys handling the ball, and UMass cannot handle Cool in the low post. So now what's going to happen is they're going to continue to try to force penetration and draw fouls. If not, they're going to throw it into Cool and let him go to work.
Braid guilty of that foul. Camby comes back in. I said Dingle on this shot was going to get it blocked. He put it over in his left hand and got it out. Look at Wisconsin. That'll be 15 wins for them if they get that victory today. They've beaten, what, Michigan?
They beat Michigan.
Illinois. They beat Iowa.
That is a team that, like a number of teams, will continue to play right down until the end of the month, the first week of March, and still have a very realistic chance of impressing the committee before Selection Sunday.
Dick Bennett has done really an outstanding job. There is a whistle and a push called. Is that Camby?
No, I thought it was Weeks. I think it was Tyrone Weeks.
Yep, that's who it's going to be on, and Bruiser Flint will take him out of the ball game. He'll go to the bench.
Yeah, he's not really had a chance to get involved in the game at all, Ron. They got in such a hole early on that UMass elected to stay with mainly all of their starters.
14-footer in and out. Cool right there for the follow and the dunk. The way they're playing, for people who haven't watched the Colonials this year, they got to be saying, how do they have five losses?
Well, you know, there's something to be said about favorable matchups against certain teams, Ron. I've seen it at the NBA level. How about Milwaukee beating New York three straight times in Madison Square Garden? Something to be said about matchups against certain teams. And right now, GW, you look at these matchups, they've got advantages at two or three different spots. Now, this could be critical because that's four
on
Alexander Cool. And he was having a party in the paint.
Ferdinand Williams quickly off of the warm-up. He'll come in. That's where he made his mistake when he got entangled.
Right, exactly. Looked like a couple of human pretzels there as they got locked up.
Well, let's put that number down. 14:07 is when he got his fourth.
And they're plus 21 at the time.
Right, way outside. That's an air ball. He hardly got cotton on that, let alone iron. Clark will take you back to the first half. The little guy who's dribbling right now. It is an 11-point game. UMass is coming down. They score it out of double figures. They turn it over. This little guy comes down and hits a three at the other end. 14-point, and the run was over.
Exactly. And then he made a pass that led to a fast break. So he hit a three and assisted on a two.
With a left-handed outlet.
Right. Exactly.
So Rodgers with certainly two key plays in the first half to reignite his team. Ferdinand Williams battling that basketball a little bit. Not real pretty on that move.
But still a pretty high quality shot in close.
Yep, he got it. And that's going to be against Vaughn Jones. Three on Vaughn Jones now.
Well, slowly now, UMass working towards the bonus, both teams with five team fouls, so it would seem that we'll be shooting free throws a good portion the rest of the way, and that certainly would favor GW.
Dingle goes to the bench. Weeks back in the lineup. 59-38. George Washington by 21 points, and Weeks put it on the floor and had it taken away. He had three Colonials all around him.
Boy, their rotations, Ron, have been splendid all day.
Missed the jam, Kwame Evans, and it goes to UMass.
Shante showing us his whole package today. Good find. Kwame tried to punch it on Camby. Marcus may have gotten away with the foul there.
Way outside with the three-pointer. Bruiser Flint.
Thought the ball had been deflected on the shot.
Yep, he sure did. And for those of you who keep repeating, in case you joined us late, you say, where's John Calipari? Well, John received two technicals at 10:31 in the first half. Tommy Evans with the three-pointer. Not there. Weeks comes away with the rebound. Trevieso with a three-point attempt. And that's over the top, and that's the way this day has gone. By the way, I stand corrected on one thing. We said it was the first time John had been ejected from a ball game. First time in this new arena. I'm told that it's twice here at UMass. And the last time was his first year. It was against GW.
GW was 1-27 that year, and guess what game that they got the victory at?
That's what I'm talking about with the matchups, the rivalry. There's something about this particular matchup that tends to favor George Washington, at least the last couple of years. I mean, this is their only meeting this year. UMass won the two games 2 years ago, and then last year, GW got both games.
He was on the sideline of turnovers. This is Jerry Donahue. And I'm also told that the guy had a very flowery story about it. He said John was colorful when he left, too. He tossed his coat in the stands. Not today, but that first time it happened. As Mike Jarvis looks on. And the thing that GW has to do right now is just keep on keeping on. Don't play not to win, or not to lose, I should say. Just keep doing what's gotten them this far. A 21-point lead.
Just tread water, basically.
Well, neither team has scored in the last 2.5 minutes, so there's a timeout. We'll be right back.
Now it's your time. It's your style. When you get on your Grand Am.
Just a quick reminder from the Grand Am people. Life is good in the right car.
State Farm presents the rules of the game.
Screening an opponent is an integral part of basketball. In this play, the offensive player sets a screen while he is still moving. Is this legal?
When young policyholders come to me, I look at them and think, boy, that was me 15 years ago. I remember very well how quickly things changed for Debbie and me. Marriage, children, our first house. That's exactly why State Farm's family insurance checkups are such a good idea. Your agent helps you put it all in perspective so you can make the right decisions. The way you were 5 years ago is not the way you are today. It's comforting to me when I can say to my policyholders, hey, I've been there.
State Farm is there.
When a player screens an opponent, he must stop before contact occurs. In this play, the screener does not stop before contact. He is still moving. He has committed a foul for an illegal screen.
Rules of the Game has been brought to you by State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Well, if you just turned this basketball game on, that score is not reversed. George Washington leading the number one team of the nation by 21 points. And at this juncture, they have held them to 38.
Boy, you look at what Mike Jarvis has done. Solid record here at GW. A couple of trips to the NCAA tournament. A controversial no bid last year. But I tell you what, I think they're a tournament team. Even if they hadn't won this game, clearly a lot of time left. But the way they're playing, you would think that with this win, they pretty much locked themselves into the NCAA tournament.
Canby can't get it off the glass. The tip won't go, and Canby has it knocked away, but he was fouled.
Boston College playing well against Georgetown right now. Boy, Jim O'Brien's done a nice job with Boston College. They've got a relatively young team, and they've been very solid in the Big East.
Padilla with the jumper. Canby, by the way, only has 2 second-half points, Clark.
Well, he hasn't been on the floor an awful lot and hasn't really gotten a lot of touches.
Jonte Rogers misses. Padilla picks it up. So Padilla with back-to-back hoops, and they'll go full-court pressure. Out of bounds by Padilla.
UMass trying to turn up the pressure a bit. And that's the way they got to get back into it. They need to get some easy scoring opportunities off their defense.
Williams will go to the bench. Masharikov will come in. Right, man, Canby.
Whoa! He can slash, and that time he just parked Canby and went right around
with great hustle on the play.
Watch out now. Bray coming at you, Marcus. Now you see him, now you don't. Mark it up.
Candy unlucky on the shot and last touched by UMass. It'll come back to GW. 61-42. Padilla hit the two hoops and they came down, couldn't get anything done. Bruiser Flint going crazy over on the sideline.
Well, he wants Padilla. I think he wants his team to continue to fight.
Take it away. Clark trying to get a pass to Padilla, who was cutting by and had it knocked out of bounds by Gray. Dante Bright with four fouls back into the lineup.
Here you see what's gone on all season long. UMass typically forces three, almost four more turnovers than they commit. Today, they committed five more than they forced.
RBS works against Evans. Nice suspending shot. Boy, that's pretty. Almost knocks it away. He does. Knocks it right over to Jones, who happened to be in the area.
Sweet finish there. Just leaned in and used the right to keep the shot for Camby away from the ball.
Juan Jones, 18 points. Right with the short jump. 17-point ball game. Full court pressure.
You know, the play we just saw Dante Bright make was one UMass thought they could get throughout the game today, but the help side defense, George Washington, has negated it.
Three-pointer is missed. Rodge on the hustle, and he gets knocked into the backcourt. Travieso will get the violation. Now, one of the things, that's four fouls on Travieso, by the way. One of the things also that John Calipari worked in this ball club yesterday was just now, and it fell for it. Rodgers with the penetration, they said he's looking to pass. He's not looking to take it to the hoop because Mark will take him inside.
Right, exactly. But he's so quick, and he has such a knack for getting to long rebounds. He's averaging almost six boards a game, and a lot of them are just the guys we saw him get there. The long rebound, he's out there around the dotted line, foul line area, and he just chases the ball down.
He is. You're right. He's second on his team in rebounding. 5-3.
What a pass. What a pass. Show us everything, Shantae.
Darren Green is the recipient. He had already jettisoned as the pass is getting there.
That was a heck of a finish by Green not to take it on the floor.
Camby. Count that one.
Needless, Kwame, that shot was going off to the right, and he was too close to the rack to try to make attempt at the block. He gave up a free deuce, and that's why the consternation on the face of Mike Jarvis.
So it's a 17-point game. 8 minutes, 32 seconds left in the game, and Padilla fouls Rodgers.
Boy, that's got to be one of the most frustrating things to have to do in basketball, is to guard a guy at 5'2 or 3 that has quickness, that has toughness, that low center of gravity, who's playing as well as Shantae Rodgers is. Watch this feed, Ron. Eyes up. And there, see, this was a good catch and finish, because if in fact Green brings that down, Wright has a chance to recover.
Dante is right there, but you're right. He had already launched his jump.
I think we've got a little blood somewhere. I think it's Camby, maybe his shin. We'll have to take a quick break if they can. Actually, he'll be substituted. Let's see if we can.
Tyron,
there it is. Yeah, it looks like a scab just had been broken loose.
Every limbo spotted the blood. Padilla's kind of walking the ball up there. I mean, kicked down by 19 points.
Yeah, you got to step on that gas pedal a little bit. Now just look, nothing really easy. Nothing easy at all for you, Master. Out of rhythm. and give George Washington an awful lot of credit for what they've been able to do today.
Evans for three. That one blocked by Bright. He wants the outlet pass, and he gets it, and Clark will finish it off with the two. First two for him in the ball game. Under 8 minutes to play. 67-50, George Washington over UMass.
George Washington able to maintain this lead, Ron, with Alexander Kuhl on the bench with the four fouls. Look for Jarvis maybe to bring him back at about the five-minute mark. And if they're still comfortably in front, that would pretty much do UMass in, I think.
Clark, that is the first bench point by either team. Clark scoring a hoop just a moment ago. Cherenkov kisses it off the glass for two, and now they're 4 points. He didn't start the ball game, so now four off the bench, two for each team. Three-pointer, that thing wasn't close. Dingle inside. Well, we asked John Calipari yesterday, said, John, what about different theories about losing the game late and ending a streak. What do you think? That's an air ball put up by Green, and he said, unless it helps my ball club, I think you ought to keep on winning. Well, they got to look to see how this one helps them today, because they're down huge. We'll be right back.
We're shaking it up in 96 with the best in family movies on the magical world of Disney. It's the world television premiere of Disney's The Lion King plus Man of the House and Rudyard Kipling's The Jungle Book. Animated hits including The Return of Jafar and DuckTales the movie Treasure of the Lost Lamp. So shake it up on the Disney Channel.
If chopping down a cherry tree was never quite your cup of tea, then here's the thing that does the trick. Just take this small remote and click. You'll see wonders dance before your eyes. Our founding fathers could surmise that cable would be quite sure 47 years ago.
Order the entertainment package and get HBO and Showtime for just $14.95. The February launch of the entertainment package.
She's a brick house. She's mighty, mighty. She's letting it all hang out. She's a brick house. That lady Jack, and that's a back, ain't holding nothing back. She's a brick house. Oh, yeah.
To George Washington, and let's take a look at the dollar run-a-car storyline. George Washington 51% for the field. Rodgers with 11 points and 8 assists. Calipari ejected with 10:31 on the clock in the first half. 17 turnovers in Bright, who averages almost 16 a game. Dante only 4 points this afternoon.
Well, if a run's going to take place, it has to happen pronto.
Yeah, it's got to start right now, because we are about to hit 6.5 minutes to play in the game. Padilla has it knocked away by Rodgers. He's done everything.
He sure has.
What a team guy. I mean, you name it.
He's controlled the game, Ron.
He really has.
Poole got him off to the good start early, but Shante Rodgers has made more critical plays in this game than anybody on the floor.
And how many people would argue and say, no, there's no way a 5-3 guy can take over and control the game, but he has.
Exactly.
And as you said, at such key times.
Timely assist, timely hoops, timely steal. Matter of fact, I ought to call him timely.
Jones couldn't get it to go. Yesa gets it out to Padilla. Three on the way. Padilla not there. Green to rebound.
You know, we're talking about GW as if this is a major surprise. When we consider that they've won 9 of their last 10, they've given UMass the only loss they have in this building. We're not that surprised, maybe just by the margin.
Clark fouled by Green. Clark says, come on, let's go. I don't like the feeling of possibly losing. You know,
we were observing and looking at the schedule that, you know, the Colonials have played a very tough schedule, but as far as getting a really quality win, they needed something like this. And I guess when you knock off an undefeated team, the number one team, that's about as quality as you can get.
Yeah, eyebrows will jump up and head north a little bit on that. But again, I still think just based on the quality of their club and the conference that they're in, I mean, people talk about the A-10 being top heavy, and that certainly is the case, but Xavier on the road is a tough team. They've got a win against Virginia Tech, who's been ranked all season long. Rhode Island is a solid club. So I think this conference is a little stronger than maybe people give it credit for being. And Temple's still very much in the thick of things, 15-11. Overall.
And of course that one loss you were talking about was to LaSalle last weekend. Otherwise it'd be 10-10. People were surprised by that one.
You know, the committee likes to look at what a team is doing lately.
That's right.
And right now what the Colonials have done all day today is control this game.
Ronnie Evans with 9 on the afternoon, 71-53. And a lot of this crowd just kind of sitting here in a stunned silence.
They're confused right now. They don't know exactly what they want to do, how they want to do it.
Marcus Camby off the mark. He only has 4 second half points. He got 10 at halftime, 14 for the game right now. The Sheriff's off. Couldn't get the handle on that one. Here's Padilla. Good dish, and Dingle will score it, and he'll call a timeout. 16-point game with 4:35 left to play, and we'll take the timeout with him.
See you at the airport, Wilkins.
Not me. I've got some unfinished business.
You work too hard.
Hard work is what made this country great, Fielding. I thought you might want to tuck under your pillow tonight, my friend.
At Dollar Rent-A-Car, we know that inside every business person, there's a fun person dying to get out. So while Dollar's convenient locations make it easy to come and go, our low rates make it even easier to stay.
See you around, Fielding.
Dollar Rent-A-Car. Dollar makes sense.
Great.
Well, it can't get any worse than this.
For the great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down.
Huh. First stand corrected.
Make it a Bud Light.
You're never gonna get it open.
To 55, George Washington. And a reminder that ESPN Radio NBA Game of the Week, Orlando Magic against the Chicago Bulls. Magic, of course, 24-0 at home, but they got to take this one on the road. Tough place to play. 12:37 tomorrow, the Bulls and the Magic.
At Xavier, you see what George Washington has left. Then Rhode Island at home at St. Joe's, and then the A-10 tournament. And I've seen that Xavier team at Cincinnati Gardens. They're young, but they're not a bad club. So that'll be a tough game for GW. But, boy, this will be a feel-good win here. And just based on the way the game has progressed, Ron, I can't really see UMass getting back into this thing unless there's a total collapse on the part of GW. They shoot free throws too well. They put inside, outside game.
Full foul by Camby. That's the second foul on Marcus. No, you're right. We're about to go under 4 minutes to play in this one. Look at this. 77% is George Washington. Is 17 of 22 today at the line. And on the season, 71%. Which was second in the league coming into today's ballgame. So if this holds on, you would suspect that the Kentucky Wildcats will move a team that UMass beat early in the year, would move into the top position in the rankings.
Boy, what a hustle play by J.J. Braid, and we still haven't seen him yet. He cleared our press table over here trying to figure out how to get back onto the court. Good work here. Oh, he mugged Travieso. Could have been called for a foul there.
Yeah, he really could
have. My goodness.
Padilla pulls up, 17-footer, well off the mark on that one, and it's Braid who rebounds.
No real rhythm offensively all day, and you have to give GW credit for that because they've been so active and pesky with their Saran Wrap D. I mean, nothing easy at all for UMass.
Rogers just dribbling through traffic, got the shot away as Candy gets the rebound. And Padilla has it knocked away from him, and they'll call the foul on Braid. We can see Braid 19 points against Maryland in a big ball game.
Right.
And you can see that the youngster, this is not the first time that he has performed extremely well for the Colonials.
Well, he gives them that element of a slasher. I mean, he shoots 58% from the floor, and you see why. He gets a number of shots in and around the goal because of his ability to run the floor on the break and then drive and slash in their half-court set.
Well, Clark, his 15 points today are very, very big, but I think his emotion has been as important as anything to George Washington.
And his defense has been excellent, too. I mean, he's been around the ball an awful lot.
Nunez into the lineup. And UMass gets the ball on the turnover. So immediately Nunez goes to the bench. And Dana Dinkle, number three, will check back into the lineup.
The thing about trying to come back from huge deficits, Ron, it's kind of like planning that special evening with your significant other. You get everything in order, and sometimes you use so much energy trying to make everything right, you can't finish the deal.
Travieso scores. They'll have an opportunity for a four-point play.
Well, UMass is going to try to finish the deal.
And it's five fouls on Cool. So that means Mishurikov will check into the ballgame.
Oh, it must have been significant contact afterwards because that, to me, looked a little bit like Casper on that foul.
Travieso can make this a 10-point ball game. Hang on, 3:32 to play. Can the Minutemen do it? A moment ago, they didn't look as though they could, and they're about to take it under double figures. Vaughn Jones walks it up against Nunez. They try to get a double in.
Strong with the ball and then make free throws if you get fouled.
Mike Jarvis actually smiling on the sideline just saying keep your cool. They want to run this clock down as far as they can. About to go under 3 minutes to play. Evans, and he was fouled by Padilla. Padilla with three now. Had almost run the 35-second clock.
Yeah, I think it's a little too early to try to do that. But again, because of the way they can play, Ron, they can spread you out. They've got three ball handlers, Rogers, Jones, and Evans. And what they want to do is try to force a situation late in the shot clock where one of those guys can penetrate because they're all pretty solid free throw shooters.
Give this crowd an E for effort. They have done everything.
Exactly. You're right.
They have really worked hard.
Never gave up on their squad, and still a lot of time left.
All five George Washington starters in double figures in scoring. You saw that balance we showed you the graphic at the beginning of the second half.
You don't have to always look for a three here. Drives and drawing fouls will work just as well for UMass.
Dangerous pass, Bright. Travieso deep in the corner. But Bright gets the rebound and count it. Dinkle will go to the line.
with an attempted three-point play, which would take it out double figures.
Nice find here by Donta Bright to Dana Dingle, his partner in crime. And in that situation with the lead, what you don't want to do if you're GW is stop the clock. Kwame really didn't have a chance to make a play there in the midst of foul. UMass continuing to fight and fight.
If he makes this right here and takes it out of double figures, it'll be since 13:44 of the first half that the lead was in single digits.
Been a while. Now this is where George Washington has to show poise.
Double on him in the backcourt. Camby tries to make the steal, and it goes right to Rogers. It's 215, 214, and counting. And the shot clock, it's 12, now down to 11.
Better get busy, Shantae.
Evans got to D on his feet and then hits the three-pointer. Oh, my goodness.
What was so impressive about that was the patience of Kwame Evans. He lifted the defender, and you see Mike Jarvis loving it. He lifts the defender right here, knows he's got enough time, and then calmly strokes the tray.
Bounce pass, Bright now, Trevieso, way outside, and he hits the three. 9 points again. And a timeout called by George Washington. So let's take the break with him. 1:36 left to play. 9-point ball game.
Try to sleep, but sleep won't come. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
For a while there, I felt like I was the only one who hadn't taken the high endurance challenge from Old Spice. It seemed like lots of guys were using it, so I gave it a shot, because this proves it deserves a shot. It evaporates less quickly, also lasts longer, protects better. Old Spice guarantees it. If you don't think it's the best, call 1-800-PROVE-IT and they'll buy you a stick of your old deodorant. Mine never guaranteed anything like that. I guess that's why it's my old deodorant. Hey, take the high endurance challenge, because now you got proof. Guaranteed.
There's Illinois State's Maurice Trotter getting ready to go up against Bradley. That's game two of our doubleheader. Now, quickly, we want to tell you about what's going on, BC and Georgetown. Here comes BC's Scooney Penn. He's got the ball, and he's going to try to go inside. Instead, it's rejected by Athella Arrington. Allen Iverson gets it going the other way. Georgetown has come back to grab the lead. Now, let's send it out to Massachusetts.
Our situation, 76-67. George Washington leading with 1:36. Timeouts, one timeout apiece. GW and UMass, no 20s left. You see the team fouls. 10 and 9. One more against UMass, and it's the double bonus. Marcus Camby. What has he done today? Marcus with 14 points. He had 10 in the first half, and he's been limited to only 4 in the second half of action. Nunez. And he will commit the foul on Vaughn Jones. So Dana Dingle and Donta Bright will come back into the lineup. Clark and Nunez go to the bench. And we have exactly 90 seconds left in this one. Of his ball club, and we talked about how unselfish, and Clark of course made the good observation a moment ago that he can play the forward spot. He's also capable of bringing the basketball up.
And he makes his free throws. Mm-hmm. Well, UMass now trying to play 3-for-2 the rest of the way. I don't know if they have enough clock to do it.
Padilla against Rogers. Bright passed up the three. Now takes it strong to the hoop. Not there. Candy on the follow. And a timeout called by UMass with 1:16 to play. So we'll take that break with him. 78-69, George Washington.
Selling a house is no vacation, but that's just what the Walkers got when they sold their house with our ERA office. The ERA Seller Security Plan guaranteed that if we didn't sell their house, ERA would buy it. ERA even agreed to take the risk of selling the house at a loss. When we sold it for more, the Walkers got the profit. They used the extra money to take a vacation. The ERA Seller Security Plan, just the kind of help you'd expect from a friend.
Call 1-800-693-7775. ERA, first in service.
Oh, honey, boy. I told you you'd love it.
You were right, sweetie. I wanted the motel. I feel like an outdoorsman.
Yeah. Look
at that, honey.
Oh, my God.
Did you hear that? Did you hear that?
What is that? What do you see? What do you see?
Oh, boy.
Honey?
What? Where's the Ericsson cellular phone?
Oh, shoot. I left it outside.
Wait, you left it outside. I got to walk there and get it.
Ericsson cellular phone. Because when life gets a little wild, you want a highly reliable Ericsson cellular phone.
Hi. Yeah, we're in a tent. There's no reason there's a huge bear out there.
The race is on. The Bradley Braves, with the best home record in the Missouri Valley Conference, are home today. But the pressure's on with the Illinois State Redbirds, sporting the best road record, invading Carver Arena. The stretch drive is here. Illinois State versus Bradley next.
Well, you see the score, 78-69, and only a minute 16 left. Turnovers in this ballgame as you look at foul trouble. Cool is out. And Rogers, Evans, Jones, and Braid all with three apiece. Bright with four, Trevieso with four, and Padilla with three. Turnovers, George Washington at 14 in this one, and 18 for UMass.
That's well above their season average at around 11 to 12, depending on which numbers you look at for UMass. And that's one of the factors in this game tonight, this afternoon, rather.
Sherikov gets free at the other end, and he gets hammered by Nunez.
Well, it's been a tough day for UMass. Canby struggled early on. There was some concern about the Cool Canby matchup in the UMass camp just because of Cool's strength. And then the game was allowed to be played in a physical manner early on. And then George Washington, very aggressive defensively to start. And then they've got solid play from every single guy that's been on the floor for them.
Sherikov gets the first one. Clark, you also have to wonder, the first 10 minutes of this ball game, we talked about the old saying, if it looked as though UMass had gotten a late wake-up call, that they just were not as focused as they thought they were when they started. If they had come out of the box just decently well for that first 10 minutes, you have to wonder, the run in the second half would have been enough, or if GW still would have gotten them.
Yeah.
Canby, they get the quick double on him, and he'll jam it home. Back to 9 points, and we're under a minute to play. Well, Gene Mangi has seen something.
I think UMass is out of timeouts, is that correct?
George Washington has one left, and UMass has none. And the question is, did you see somebody call timeout, Clark? Because I did.
Well, I didn't either. Well, I don't know if, in fact, you can substitute.
All right, then that's what the question is, because
after the May field goal,
what they've been doing is Clark and Nunez have been coming on the floor. We have the fouls to give, and Bright and Dingle go to the bench, and then they come right back in after either change of possession or timeout, or the clock is stopped.
Right, and it stops on every score the last minute.
Bruiser Flint, the acting head coach of UMass here, with John Calipari being ejected back in the first half. And that foul's on Clark. Now he goes to the bench with Nunez, and that means that Bright and Dick will come back in for 3 and 4. Illinois State and Bradley coming up immediately following this one. And we have 53.7 seconds left, and it's a 9-point game with GW on top.
Great, the only guy out there for GW that doesn't shoot better than 70% from the line right now. He's at 61% in conference play. But because it was intentional, he gets in there. They're into the double bonus. He gets two.
Padilla against Rogers. 10-point George Washington lead. Padilla way outside. Camby knocks it back to Bright, and he will score. I think Dingle is the man who's going to get with the foul. Now Padilla. And that's number 4 on Padilla.
Here you take a look at what's going on in Atlantic 10 right now. UMass, with this loss today, would drop to 14-1, 26-1. Temple at 10-4, 15-11 overall, and having played one of the toughest schedules anywhere, and with two wins, one over Kansas, one over Villanova, that certainly are impressive. GW in the midst of winning their 10th in their last 11 outings. And Rhode Island kind of hanging around, although I think they maybe needed to win against UMass to have a realistic shot at getting to the NCAA tournament.
Ray battling for it. Boy, he went down and hit that table hard.
He's been everywhere, hasn't he? Boy, he's had a tremendous game. This whole Colonial Club really has. And I don't know if I want to take credit away from them in terms of looking at UMass's start, because I think they created part of that start.
I agree with you.
Because of their aggressive posture and their solid play defensively.
DSO with the three-pointer. Jones will grab the rebound. And on the reach-in, Dante Bright will get his 5th foul. So Clark will come into the lineup, and on Bright today, he finishes with 6 points. Clark, we talked about Bright in the first half and the fact that he was having real difficulties at shooting with his 6 points. He is 3 of 13 from the field today.
And sometimes when you get a couple of easy ones early, Ron, and they don't go, you start wondering a little bit. And again, you have to continue to press the defensive effort of GW, because George Washington was aggressive and they challenged an awful lot of those shots early on, and did so throughout the remaining portion of the game.
That one is Candy grabs the rebound. Under 20 seconds to play. Trevieso with the three, got it. 8-point game, 84-76, under 20. And Rogers gets hammered by Candy with 11 showing on the clock. And Kenny May, let's check with you in the beginning of that Bradley Illinois State game.
Hey, Ron, Illinois State and Bradley are underway, and as advertised, we will bring you the doubleheader of that game coming up, but we got a major upset in the making here. Ron Franklin's going to finish the call of this one.
All right, Kenny, as we said, 11 ticks showing on the clock, and this guy at the line today, if you've never seen him play, yeah, he's 5'3", but he's proven all his life that he can make things happen. And there are some smiles across the way on that Colonials bench, and they should, because the little man got even bigger today and really helped his teammates. Rogers has got 15 points. Shot by Padilla off the mark, down to 3, down to 2.
And this one is history. George Washington has won their second in a row here in the Mullen Center, upsetting the number one team in the nation, UMass, 86-76. For Clark Kellogg, Ron Franklin saying so long from Amherst, and let's go direct to Dwayne Statz and Derek Dickey.